Thank you, Professor Brown. You know, of course, well, I'd like to begin by thanking you for coming out in such awful weather. You know, I retired this spring with joy that I was retiring, in spite of the fact that I enjoyed every minute of my 41 years of teaching on the university level. The only slight flaw in retiring was that I would no longer have Professor Brown as my boss. I contributed my fifth just before I retired to the fact that she was unanimously re-elected head of our department last year. We have a prize in her. Last time, I portrayed the sweep that had been concerned with 1,000 years as a period in 976 when we had no state at all. All power was private power, but we also had really no individual. That is, no isolated individual. All that we had were individuals so deeply embedded in local communities, local self-sufficient communities, that their power relationships within which they functioned were in their day-to-day activities, and the controls of their behavior were almost totally internalized in their neurological and hormone systems. So that they obeyed what seemed to them to be their inner compulsion, and what they were doing was fulfilling the functions they had in this interwoven community structure, which changed so slowly that even with a long life, and of course most people in those days did not live long lives, but even in a long life, let us say of 60 or 70 years, almost no changes would be noticed by anyone in the patterns that were fitting, which they had embedded inside of themselves. And at the end of the 1,000-year period, in the year in which we now are, we no longer have communities, except shattered, broken, crippled ones, isolated ones. Instead, we have states of monstrous power and frustrated individuals, isolated individuals. The state and the individuals working together from opposite sides to destroy what we have left of communities. Local, family, or whatever they might be. Over this long period of 1,000 years, the growth of the state, which is our subject, is marked by the beginnings of public power, the appearance of a state apparatus of a very primitive kind made up of the king and his assistants, which eventually became a monarch and a bureaucracy. And around this core, there gradually accumulated sufficient activities to make what we would regard as a public authority, and eventually a state. And the mark of that can be most clearly, I think, indicated by the development of what we call sovereignty. Without sovereignty, I do not think we would say that a state is much of a state, although we might call it that. Now, there's been a great deal of talk in books about sovereignty, not, unfortunately, in history books very much, but no one has ever bothered to define it. And from my study of the growth of the state, I have been able to, it seems to me, put together what sovereignty consists of, at least historically, in the tradition of our Western civilization.
And it seems to me it has eight
functions or aspects, and the approximate order in which they appeared are these. First, all human needs require that a person live and cooperate with other people for satisfaction. None of us can satisfy any significant human need by acting alone in a state of nature. The two fundamental ones from the beginning are that the group within which a community is satisfying its functions and needs must be defended from outside attack. So the first aspect is defense. Secondly, disputes and conflicts within the group must be settled so that insiders do not fight with each other, but cooperate rather than open themselves to enemy attack. So defense is first against outsiders. Judicial activity is second, that means disputes among insiders. The third one is very difficult to talk about. I once, years ago, gave a whole course upon it. The administrative power. The French word for it, that is in the study of French public law, and most of my study was done in the French language and in French public law, is la police. It does not mean police, it rather means policy. And I suppose the best way to define it would be to say, the power to take those discretionary actions which are necessary for the continued existence of the community. In the Middle Ages and in the Dark Ages with which I began in 976, when the chief need was the food supply. And by the 18th century, the early 18th century in France, if you simply said la police, what it meant was control of the grain trade. However, in strict legal understanding, it meant much more. For example, it meant what emergency measures would be taken and who would order them if a plague appeared, that the dead must be buried the same day, and things of this kind. That everyone must get a swine flu injection. La police. Now, notice it's nothing that you can designate, but it's the most significant power, administrative power. And when I taught the subject, I pointed out and shocked the students by saying, in my opinion, it is almost the most important of the eight aspects of sovereignty, and there is no provision, whatever, for it in the Constitution of the United States. And when people talk in terms of three branches of government, or three aspects of government, as they did sometimes in England, they tended to call, as the Lord Chief Justice of England, Lord Hewitt, did around 1935, the headless fourth branch of government. He wrote a book whose title was The New Despotism, the headless fourth branch of the government. And yet I can show him that where 1,000 years before his book, it had existed as one of the attributes of what is necessary to keep a community or a group of people cooperating together and keep it functioning. Last belief. I emphasize that the power is discretionary, and the finest example I can give you of that is a police officer directing traffic at a busy intersection, who has the power to start and stop the traffic as he judges fit, and enforce that with the power of the state. And it does not obey any of the rules of public authority which the common lawyers of today insist is necessary. But I might as well keep my passion on that subject for the third lecture. Where they destroy the efforts to create administrative power in this country. When the Interstate Commerce Commission was created, that was the first effort, in 1889, and have since absolutely paralyzed and made it impossible
a number of things. One thing was insisting that much used procedures of common law court, which is not the discretionary power. That's just as if you asked that a policeman who's directing traffic down here at the Key Bridge end of M Street should obey the common law procedural requirements. All right, that is the third. The fourth is, quite obvious, the taxing power. Mobilizing resources for public purposes. Notice that the French government, when the French Revolution started in 1789, did not have the taxing power, but I'll get back to that. The third is legislative power. Now, here there's always been confusion, because for many centuries, and certainly back in 976, there was no legislative power. And yet there were laws and the rules, and the reason was that in a society largely dominated by communities in which personal behavior is largely controlled by internalized control, in such a situation, the rules are not made by an outsider. You discover what the rules are by observing how people act, and according to the law was found and not made. And it was a very drastic innovation when we shifted from finding the law to making the law, and we haven't really yet made that transition completely in the common law country, where we still say that the judges are finding the law as if by looking back to previous decisions rather than previous actions of people. But originally the law was found, and when the world judges first began to go around them and trying cases, they never said, this is the law. They gathered together a group of men, sworn local people, and they said, what do you do in a case like this? And they said, we generally do this. Now, in some cases, they would look positive and say, the memory of no one here has such a case that they are asking or something of this kind. And then the judge would say, well, in traveling around and trying cases, I have found that the most common rule is, and thus we established the common law. So the common law in England was the law which the royal judges discovered going around and finding out what the law was, and fitting in gaps with what was common to England. Notice, the common law of England was a royal creation from its true local custom. The law in France, as I showed you last time, was the writing down of local customs in all of their diversity. The legislative process, I'll say a little more about it, but the first examples of writing down were not regarded as making new rules at all. They were simply promulgations of custom. And it was a long time before people realized that we did, in fact, have a legislative process going in and were on and were making new rules. It was centuries before people knew this. All right, that's the fifth aspect, legislation. The sixth aspect, we might as well call executive, and it's of relative little importance, is the enforcement of laws and judicial decisions. And the executive action became increasingly necessary as time went on, communities disintegrated, and people's behavior became less and less subject to internalized control, and had to become increasingly subject to externalized control, such as force, duress, threat, fines, restitution, or other kinds of outside external pressure. Today, we think almost entirely in terms of law and order. If somebody campaigns for the presidency in law and order, what he's saying is he's going to intensify the external controls upon behavior that people don't approve of. Exactly. Now, the last two are of tremendous importance, and they are perhaps the most important today,
and yet they are rarely discussed in connection with sovereignty. The seventh is money control. I pointed out last time that from the very beginning, going back to the very earliest days, I would say it wasn't 500 BC, coinage and control of money was one of the attributes of royalty. But of course today it includes much more than just coinage. It means the creation and control of money and credit, and in the English-speaking world, this is not a part of sovereignty. It is in private hands, even though it is perhaps the most important power that exists in a society such as ours today. And the last aspect of sovereignty, the incorporating power. That is, the right to say that a group of people is a single legal entity. That is to create corporations. This did not exist in the English-speaking world until quite late. It existed in the Roman law always. One of the distinctive things different about the Roman law was that all that existed was the imperium, public authority, and individuals. That's all that existed. If there existed any other legal groups, and by legal I mean that they had the right to own property and to sue or be sued in court, then they had to have some kind of a charter from the imperial power to justify this. Now, of course, with the fall of Rome, that ceased entirely, and corporations in the year 970, and there were thousands of them all over Europe, many of them ecclesiastical, but some other kinds as well. It was never quite clear, for example, whether each diocese was a corporation, whether each parish was a corporation. Certainly, we generally knew that each monastery or convent was a corporation, and so forth, but there were certainly thousands of them, and they did not have any charter of incorporation. All right, those are the eight aspects of sovereignty. Now, what I have shown them in this way, it's quite clear that when I come to the end of tonight's lecture in 1789, very few states in Europe will have all of them. And indeed, when I begin the lecture tonight in 1576, almost no state in Europe had all of them. However, we could, if a state had a good try at them, and had six of them installed, and had most of them, six of them at least, you might say, it was a sovereign state, or a sovereign entity. Now the next aspect is, how was it possible to build up a sovereign entity around the basic core, which had to exist, because unless there was something there of administrative nature, and in almost every case, what was there, there are a few exceptions, city-states, like Venice, and so forth, which did not have a monarch. But all land, extensive landed territories had a monarch. Unless that monarch had the system, which I would call a bureaucracy, then you could hardly expect that the attributes of sovereignty would accumulate. In accumulating them, however, the king and his bureaucrats needed something else. They needed a life outside. And they found the reason they needed these lives is, of course, they needed money. They needed personnel, which I mentioned last time, that is, people who could read, write, keep records, count their money, and so forth. And these people would have a seal, indicating they were doing it by authority of the king, and so forth, and the collection of seals is quite interesting. I've been in archives where the seals were lying around, loose on the floor, and I did want to pick up a couple. One in particular that was a beautiful Richard III, I believe it was, seal of green wax. But they wouldn't let me take two that were lying there. They were papal bulls.
of the late medieval period. They had somehow been cut off. Take fools who are about to put a quarter in their leg with very garish silk strings attaching them to the document. They break off quite easily. The garish strings are either bright, they're bright yellow and red together. Both. Now, the gradual development in the 1,000 years that we're concerned with, which we would call economic expansion and growth, and the resulting social change, made it possible for the monarchy to find philosophy. And I don't believe I will take the time to write them on the board here, but I will say, at the beginning, all that we had were lords and serfs, a kind of a two-class system. Then, when the king began to appear with his bureaucracy, and we'll put him outside of the classes, the lords separated, and that was in the 13th century, I mean the 11th century, as a result of the investiture struggle, into the lords spiritual, as the clergy, and the lord temporal, what we would call the nobility, and the peasants. So we have a three-class system. And eventually the beginnings of commerce and the growth of towns gave rise to a middle class, the merchants, the burghers, and you would put them in there. So you would now have peasants, burghers, nobles, clergy, and above it all still the king with his bureaucracy. That you would have those by the year 1300, very clearly established. Within 150 years, when they reached a great crisis, in fact, they reached a crisis within 50 years, you had an additional one. In the cities, craftsmen, in guilds, woodworkers, leather workers, people of this kind. And you might make a distinction and say that not every landlord was a noble. There were lesser landlords who were not nobles. And in fact, in England, they were a very vitally important group. They're frequently called the gentry. That would be, let us say, around 1400 or certainly 1450. And you would thus have the clergy, nobles, gentry, burghers, craftsmen, peasants. And then if we come up past this night's lecture in the 19th century, past 1776, you would find that you had a new kind of bourgeoisie in the city, the industrial bourgeoisie, and this created a new kind of working class in the city, the proletariat, while craftsmen were being pushed aside and so forth. I won't come up to that now. Now, what the monarch had to do was to find allies down below in order to accumulate powers where he would be resisted. His first ally, of course, was the clergy, who was resisted by the nobility. But soon the clergy and the nobility allied together, and he was being resisted by them jointly. He found then allies in the bourgeoisie, in the merchants, the sons of merchants who could read and write and count, and indeed were much more loyal to the king than any clergy had ever been. And in England and other places, they found allies amongst the gentry. In Eastern Europe, in Germany, the Junker, younger sons of the landed class, and so forth. Notice that at no time, at least in the first two lectures, did the king find any allies worth talking about in what was really the most important group in society, the peasants who were producing the food for everyone else. And one of the things in my studies that I've been making in the past 10 years on this whole problem has been that it is of no use to have something, no matter how essential it is, and expect that it will be a source of power. If you take basic things that everyone needs, like food, and I assume sex, maybe health, things of this kind, you will never find the possession of these has ever given the possessors or the people who supply
the community with them enough power to play any role in political action. So we just leave the peasants out of it. Not all of these, but, obtained status and became a focus of political authority. Those that did form what is the subtitle of the lecture tonight, a state. And the number of estates which should exist in a community is no real criterion or sign of the number of social classes that they have. I've given you six social classes here that many places have, let us say, in 1789. I don't know any country that had six estates, however. In England, they had two estates, the Lord, Temple, and Spiritual, and then the Commons. And the Commons was made up of the gentry from the shires and the bourgeoisie from the municipalities. So they had then four classes, but only two houses. Now, the significant thing in English history, which I want to emphasize, is that England did have what you certainly would call, I think, a sovereign state very early, certainly by 1400. And it had that sovereign state, however, not in the hands of the king, but instead in the hands of a joint corporation, known technically as Rex in Parlamento, the king in Parliament. And this possessor of sovereignty, Rex in Parlamento, or Prince in Parliament, if you wish, is, I'm quite sure, and I haven't investigated it exhaustively, is quite sure it is not just English. It's Northern monarchy. In other words, you'll find the oldest parliament in the world today, and it's more than 1,000 years old, is in Iceland, and other old ones are in Norway and Denmark and places like this. And this idea of a ruler having power to do almost anything if the parliament agrees is the real basic background of a tremendous political power like Gustavus Adolphus in the 1630, in the 30 Years' War. All right, that is in England. But if you go into France, you'll find there are three estates. There's the clergy, the nobility, and the rest, called the third. In France, there was a certain representation there for the peasants. They did have representatives the same as anybody else. But as you certainly know, the so-called estate general did not meet for 175 years. It was not called to assemble after 1614 until it was forced to be called to meet in 1789, and that's what started the French Revolution. And the reason it wasn't called was because the king did not want more problems than he had. And he would have had more. All right, now, if you go further east, you'll find places where there are four, and there are some places where there are five estates. And in the course of history, some of them change. They eliminate groups until finally they reduce the number and so forth. Now, the next point that I have to make is extraordinarily complex. I have to make a distinction, which I have already been developing, that if you go across Europe, the situation is quite different the further east you go. I've already showed you a tremendous difference between England and France. But there are two other zones that we must deal with. France goes from the English Channel to the Rhine. Western Germany goes from the Rhine to the Elbe River. Eastern Europe goes from the Elbe River to the Pint marshes or the Kripkat River, which is considerably east of Warsaw and is the natural boundary between Europe and Asia, and is very close to the actual boundary today between Russia and Poland. It's a little further east. Now, these four had totally different experiences. and I want to look at them a little bit. And I glance at my notes. I say zonal differences. These zonal differences became crucial in what happened to monarchical authority and estate power, depending upon what happened to the estate. So I think it's perfectly justifiable to call this 200 years the age of estates. If we look at the four parts of Europe, which I put here, a general rule which you might keep in mind is that the more extensive the power, that is, the greater acreage you had, the less intense it was. Extension at the sacrifice of intention. By intention, I mean, how far down socially does the royal power go? And you will find that in almost no place did the royal power go down where it interfered with the behavior of peasants, now, which would be 80% of the whole population. I won't go there. I could give you a periodization of this, but there's no point in it. Now, these four sections are usually introduced by saying it's like a ham sandwich. That is to say, England and Eastern Europe are similar in certain ways, although very different in others. The chief similarity I want to point out at once is this. England was an area of large estates. Eastern Europe was an area of large estates. But France and West Germany were areas of family-sized farms. In the Middle Ages, if we go back to 976, no one owned the land. People had rights of usage in the land. But eventually, some troublemaker, and according to Rousseau, he should have been struck dead or something, asked, who owns this land? The question should never have been asked. That is asking, who has proprietas in this land? Instead, they should have continued as the Middle Ages did, what dominia exists in this land and who owns them? And that's what you'll find in the question that William the Conqueror asked in 1087 when he sent out people in the Doomsday Survey. They asked not who owns it. They said, of whom is this land held? Who holds it? What people live upon it? What obligations do they have? And questions of this kind, which makes it possible, rather dimly, to use the Doomsday Survey to create a social structure of England in 1087. Now, these changes, and you can see how drastic it is. If England had large estates, serfdom ended in England by 1300. By 1300, in Eastern Europe, serfdom was really just the beginning. And they also had large estates. In Eastern Europe, serfdom was still there, and in Germany by 1800, and only the defeats by Napoleon made them make up their minds they had to abolish it in approximately 1808. As you know, if we leave Europe and go into Asia, in Russia, they did not abolish serfdom until 1863, just before the time we freed our slaves. So the history of serfdom is entirely different. It was eliminated just about totally in England simply because people, instead of working on someone's land a couple of days a week, paid him money, a penny a day. So they made an agreement, you won't have to work for me anymore, and I'm just as glad because I'm not going to grow things to eat, I'm going to grow wool from sheep or something of this kind. So you owe me 2 days' work a week, give me 2 pennies a week instead. Unfortunately, in the English judges, and I'll show you why in a moment, said that payment is rent. And if it's rent, it's an indication that the lord owns the land. Therefore, the peasant has no real rights in the land, or he wouldn't be paying rent. Now, in France,
Those obligations to work and to do other things, what we call manorial dues, still existed in the French Revolution and were not abolished until the 4th of August of 1789, but they were not of great significance. They were a nuisance, and they did not involve weak work or things of that kind. That all had been paid off, and had been paid off by money which had, because of the inflation, and the whole history of France, the history of inflation, shows that the value of money had become so small that the payments that had been agreed upon was hardly worth collecting. Now, let us look at a number of things. What law existed in England? The common law, I told you. It was the law that was found in France. It was the local customs which had been written down. In Germany, West Germany, a totally different situation. We had, in the western part of Europe, in the 16th century, what we call Renaissance and Reformation. But in Germany, they had Renenref and Rex, the reception, because they generally took over the Roman law in the 16th century. And this meant that the prince became the head, and if he can make Roman law be obeyed, he becomes sovereign in that way. And he used that power to protect the landholding of the peasantry rather than to protect the rights of the nobles or the clergy. Furthermore, as a result of the Renaissance, the prince in Western Germany also became head of the church. Well, that's the way it was in Roman law. The Roman emperor was a supreme pontiff, Pontifex Maximus, the head, chief judge of all the priests in the Roman system, and so forth. So, by the reception of the Roman law, Western Germany became sovereign. The king became, or the prince, because most of them were not kings. The reason they were not kings is that you couldn't adopt the title of king in the Holy Roman Empire except with the permission of the emperor. And the emperor would not generally allow that unless paid him off, or was somebody, for instance, the Wittelsbach family, he could trust. That's in Bavaria. So he allowed them to be called king of Bavaria. But he couldn't trust the Hohenzollern up in the north in Prussia, so they could not become kings of Brandenburg. They were elector of Brandenburg, but when they wanted to take the title of king in 1701, they could not take it in the Holy Roman Empire, so they took it in Prussia, which was outside of the Holy Roman Empire to the east. And the correct name was not King of Prussia, although that within 100 years that was adopted, it was King in Prussia. So he was elector of Brandenburg and King in Prussia, without the Habsburg, because they were mostly the emperors were Habsburg, without their permission. Now, if you go further east, what happened is the rulers did not have the money, and above all, could not find the skilled personnel to keep his records. He couldn't build up the bureaucracy. He did not want to build up the bureaucracy out of town people, and the towns were few and far between. Furthermore, the towns in Germany were collapsing into a long period of depression, beginning around right in the Renaissance period, certainly by 1500. So what they did generally, the princes in Eastern Europe, is that they used for their bureaucracy the younger sons, that's where the word Junker comes from, or the nobility themselves and the gentry themselves, and they used them as their administrators. But they did not pay them, so they were not paid officials. And naturally, as administrators, they would be administrators only in their own localities, where they would systematically administer to their own benefit and not necessarily to the benefit of the ruler, the prince. Now, as a result of this, all the earlier monarchs in that period, in that area, in Eastern Europe vanished. And generally, the state that they represented vanished with them. It's worth pointing this out. Why did these kingdoms, Lithuania, or principalities, Transylvania, Kingdom of Bohemia, above all, the Kingdom of Poland, why did they vanish? And the answer is, they vanished because the prince or king found himself facing an estate that was made up very largely of landlords, and he could not get the money or the skilled bureaucracy or the other things that he needed. He really couldn't even get the army because without money he couldn't hire mercenaries. And as a result, they were able to destroy him. Now, how they destroyed him was this, in most cases. They refused to admit that his family had any hereditary rights to the throne. And it is correct that kingship originally was not a hereditary title. It was an elective title. And it was only after years that it gradually became accepted that the kingship should be inherited, and inherited by fundamental laws of the monarchy. These elective kingships were suicidal, not just for the kingship, but for the country itself. The reason is that the estates would elect as king only that man who promised to reduce the royal power the most. We almost got a competition in this in the 1976 election. If we had Ford and Reagan running against each other, and I would sort of like to see that, except you'd have to take one or the other, I suppose, and there's not really any choice, but they would be saying, I will govern less. I will cut back taxes. I will cut back big government. I will do all these kind of things to reduce the government. Now, this is what the elected monarchs of Eastern Europe did, and as they did this, they eventually had no powers at all. And at that point, you got the military revolution, which began about 1440, and which was well established by 1579. By the military revolution, I mean this. The previous weaponry, particularly in Eastern Europe, was mounted nobles on horseback with spears, in what we would call knights. But after 1500, and certainly after 1400, these were not successful. Infantrymen with spears, such as the Swiss pikemen, or infantrymen, if they could be protected by spearmen or by obstacles of various kinds, who had missile weapons, such as guns, arquebusiers, and above all, artillery, which would smash down the castles of nobles, were necessary not only to control the nobles in your own country, as the King of France did and the King of England did, but it was also necessary to protect your country against outside invaders. And the estates controlled by landlords in Eastern Europe refused to permit that military revolution. They would rather go down to defeat as an obsolete system of weaponry if they could be certain that they would retain control of all the people who lived on their estate, which the king had already granted to them. And this is why you got, in Eastern Europe, large estates, increasingly prevalent and abject serfdom, the domination of a landed group, and even one, as you know, in Poland, they even established that if a single landlord said no, it couldn't be done. The free veto. It's as if we had a parliamentary body that any time it made a decision, it had to be unanimous.
And the reason is because they were going to stick together and they would get what they could in their own little area. But they were anti-cities. They did not want people in cities who were trading. If any trading went on, they wanted it themselves. And they wanted foreigners, such as the Dutch or the Swedes or others, to come, or the Germanic cities or the Hanseatic cities, to come right into their estates in the Vistula River and others. And they would then trade to them the goods that they were producing with serf labor. That is grain, wool, hide, lumber, things of this kind. So as a result, Eastern Europe fell backward into a colonial area. Its trade and its middle class more or less vanished. The cities became of no importance, and the trade in the cities was largely taken over by foreigners and aliens, many of them Jews. And this is where the ghettos and tales of Eastern European cities came. Incidentally, it's not unique just in Poland. It went on in many other places because this was a regular process where you have a landed group in control of a society. They are very likely to destroy commercial activity and allow it to fall in the hands of foreigners and aliens, like the Ottoman Empire allowed it to fall in the hands of French and Greeks and various others. The people in Russia allowed it to fall in the hands of Greeks and various others and so forth. But this is a widely prevalent system. Another thing that marks a difference here, and I'm not going to give all of the differences, is corporative bodies cease to be of much significance. In other words, guilds cease to be important, the same way the towns, and these are the two key secular corporate bodies that we would find. And indeed, the church as corporate bodies tended to become part of the landlord system also. So that a prince or a princely family would also be the archbishop and the bishop. And in some cases, as in Prussia, Albert of Brandenburg, who was bishop in at least three different places, and archbishop, I believe, in two places, became the prince, the Hohenzollern prince of Prussia, which meant that he was taking over the corporations. On the other hand, in Western Europe, corporative systems, the guilds, and above all the towns, have a vitality and life of their own and an independent role in law, in spite of the fact that in a truly sovereign state, you would not have corporations unless they had an incorporating charter, as I've indicated to you. Generally, in the period of the state, governing functions were not centralized, they were not uniform, they were assigned to different persons, different groups, different boards, different committees, and on an ad hoc basis, without any rational distinction such as we would expect. And this went down in many cases to the low levels of villages or parishes, although I can guarantee that there were very infrequently peasants, and almost as infrequently a parish priest found on these governing boards. In this period, right through up to well into the period we're concerned with this evening, dynastic monarchy was essentially a personal thing. If you go back to the beginning, you had feudalism with no monarchy, or no monarchy of any significance. The next stage is called feudal monarchy. There, allegiance and loyalty is owed to the monarchy only by his vassals. But then you have the period that we're in tonight, dynastic monarchy, where loyalty and allegiance is due to the dynasty in which the monarch belongs, but it's always on a personal basis. Your allegiance is owed to the existing member of that family, the Tudors or the Bourbons
or the Hohenzollerns or whatever it is, and it's a personal one. However, by the period we're dealing with tonight, from 1576 to 1776, the loyalty was expected from any people who are active political participants. Now that would still be much less than 20% of the population, probably. Because, let's say, it still included no peasants, and they were probably 80% least. And there were others too. So it was a personal thing. Treason was disloyalty to a person, or to the dynasty. It was not disloyalty to the state, to the community, or to the territory in which people live.
All right, let me look very briefly at these.
In England,
sovereignty was achieved early. Rex in Parlamento, large estates, use of the gentry for unpaid services, and the gentry were unpaid members of parliament. They were also unpaid local justices, the justice of the peace, and so forth. The law that was practiced was the common law. Now, one of the things that's important here is, how do you become a judge? Do you have to know the law? And if you have to know the law, how do you learn it? The local justice of the peace in England, which was the lowest level of justice throughout all this period and even later, right up until the 20th century, was the justice of the peace. He was not expected to know the law. He was unpaid, and he was the local magistrate. Now, if he wanted to learn the law, he did not go to a law school, really. Certainly not to the university. Because the common law was not taught in universities. Instead, it was taught in four very expensive eating clubs in Westminster. The Inns of Court, the Middle Temple, Lincoln's Inn, and so forth. Inner Temple, the four Inns of Court. And these were expensive. You had to eat meals there. You had to listen to the lawyers talking about, you see, they were there. They were the places where the judges and lawyers who were trying cases in Westminster spent the evening during the judicial session. And they not only discussed the cases that were going on each day, but men who were regarded as authorities gave discussions afterwards in the lounge in regard to contracts or whatever it would be. And in this way, you could pick up the necessary knowledge of the law. But this was expensive. To join the Inns of Court required, hundreds and hundreds of guineas, which would mean hundreds and hundreds of dollars in our land. Only the landed oligarchy could afford it. And this, only people who were lawyers and had passed the bar through this process could become judges. So what you had was, which is true of England's history, a very small hole through which circulation was allowed for people to work their way up. But it was an educational loophole that they had to squeeze their way through, and it was expensive in most cases. And the result was that only those people who had affluent parents, and for much of England's history, at least up until the period we're concerned with at the end of this lecture tonight, that is to 1776, the only affluent parents which most people had would be the gentry landlord class. So your older son would take over the estate, your second son would perhaps go into the navy or the army, or you would find him a place in the church, a living, as they called it, and then your third son would perhaps go to the inner court and try and become a lawyer. By 1776, and this will end my discussion of England, which is very brief and, as you see, inadequate, you had a landed oligarchy in England. And that landed oligarchy controlled the parliament. It had taken it away from the king, so you now have sovereignty in Parlamento. It's taken away in the civil wars of the 17th century. And that same land oligarchy had control of the court system, of the interpretation of the law, and naturally, when any occasion arose, when there was a dispute, what rights does someone have in this piece of land, they invariably decided in favor of the landlord group and against any other group, above all, any peasant. And the result was that England's rural areas became depopulated. And that's why, in the early 1700s, Goldsmith wrote The Deserted Village. Sweet Arvin, loveliest village of the plain, but there's no one there. Or you read Elegy in a Country Churchyard. Once again, there's no one around. The whole countryside is deserted by the 18th century. And they came to America, and this, or they went to other places, and this gave us, eventually, the British Empire. Now, France I'm saving, because I'm going to end up with France, in West Germany. There had been, originally, much later than France, an emperor. But because the emperor was elective, the same thing occurred to him which happened to all elective kings and princes. That is, he had to make concessions, go into debt, to get the necessary money and necessary votes in order to be elected emperor. And the empire thus disintegrated into principalities which the emperor could not control. However, the emperor, as long as he continued to exist, and technically continued to exist until 1806, when his name was changed from Holy Roman Emperor to Habsburg Emperor of Austria by Napoleon. If you want an imperial title, you can have one for Austria, but you can't have it for the Holy Roman Empire, and so forth. The imperial title still existed, but all the rights and powers of the Habsburgs were the powers of the hundreds of other inheritances which they had. The most significant, of course, they were Archdukes of Austria, but they were kings of Hungary, kings of Bohemia, and many, many other things, as you know. Now, as a result of this integration, what you got were small sovereign principalities. Some of them so small that we are told you could walk around the circumference of the principality before breakfast. And without spending any time upon it, I want to point out that, in my opinion, the greatest period of European history in the post-medieval period, certainly up until 1800, up to the time of Napoleon, was Western Germany in the late 18th century. And I think you will see, if you make a list of the great geniuses in the history of Europe, that they are clustered in that period. I won't attempt to do it, but think of the greatest mathematician. Now, Englishmen will always say Newton. But it was a German in that period, the greatest musician. Or, if you dispute it, two or three great musicians.